Hi, everybody, and welcome to my interview with Bright. Is that right, Bright?
Bright, yes.
And Bright is part of the Bangkok Historical Fencing.
Yes, so we are like a fencing group, but I thought we do mostly historical European martial arts, so it's like long sword, sword and spear, sword and buckler, and sabre, kind of like that.
Cool. And then could you talk about how long Bangkok Historical Fencing has been in Bangkok?
So we've been doing this for like almost 3.5 years. So at first our group, we like don't know anything about sword or like long sword and stuff or anything about HEMA. I don't even know what HEMA is, but my friend, he got in contact with another person that like referred to me because I do sword in Thailand a lot. And they know that I actually have long sword, but I don't know how to use it. So they kind of like get in touch with me, and then we form a group. And fortunately, nobody know about long sword, but somehow we find a person, an instructor that actually like know about HEMA for like 10 years, and he helped us out for the first like years on our goal and stuff.
And then what? Who was the guy that knew it for about 10 years?
So the name is Pontus Weiker, and I think he's from like Netherlands or something.
Okay.
And he's really good with sword and long sword stuff. He's actually like learned from like a top HEMA teacher and competitor in like Europe.
Oh, okay.
And the stuff he teaches is like really good basic for us.
Cool. And so, you mentioned that you have a background in sword fighting, or before you got into HEMA, you really liked swords, right?
Yeah. So I've been doing it for like 10 years now. So this year is like 2020. So back then, from like high school, I've been doing sword, from like Thai sword, that's like Kapika Bong, sword and shield, dual wielding, and Kenjutsu. I also do Muay Thai. Now I teach knife throwing. Sword, archery, I can do almost every stuff now.
Oh, cool. And then how, what's a Thai sword like?
Thai sword is like a, you think it's like a machete.
Oh, okay.
But with a bit longer handle, like twice the handle of a machete. And it's just a small sword. About like, in American, it's like inches, right?
Uh-huh.
So it's about, overall length is about 40 inches. So it's real small, it's like this small.
Uh-huh.
But you wield with two hands, and you do like a furry stuff, and it's gonna look like very magical.
Uh-huh.
There's like gonna be a lot of things going around. And it's really confusing.
Huh. And so is that dangerous? Do you still have all your hands?
I still have all my limbs with me. I still have all my finger, all my ears, nose, and everything. My back of the head is okay and fine, but I do get like a lot of cut. Like superficial cut. Somewhere.
Okay, and then were they real sword or were they real knives or like dull knives, like practice knives or
for safety?
Uh-huh.
I think every school teach people with like stick first, like uh-huh. a wooden stick, and then gradually we amp up the intensity. Then we go with like a blunt sword, then we go with sharp sword.
Uh-huh.
Because if you train with stick, you're gonna remember it as a stick and a sword,
uh-huh.
and then you lack the urgency that you like handling like a sharp object.
Uh-huh.
And when you train with stick and then you transfer to like using real sword that is sharp, everything is gonna go wrong. Okay? Because you know now you handle like some 30 inches long razor edge or something,
uh-huh.
and the form is gonna be bad and you're gonna be afraid of using it, and that's gonna lead you to like cut yourself.
Okay. And so you said you first started Muay Thai.
Yes.
And then how old were you when you started Muay Thai?
About like sophomore year.
Okay.
So it's like 17, 18.
And then do you think Muay Thai prepared you for working with swords?
Yes, it's like a foundation for everything.
Uh-huh.
When learning martial art of any kind, you should pick up like two things at once if you can.
Uh-huh.
At least pick up like an empty hand art, whatever, Muay Thai, Taijutsu, Karate, Chinese stuff, anything that's empty hand. And then you should pick another one that's actually like a sword, mm-hmm. like a weapon art, because each stuff is gonna complement each other. And people say that empty hand translates to sword, and sword translates to empty hand. You can say it that way, but some of the stuff can like translate to each other. Uh-huh. It's like a separate art because you can punch a person and they can take a hit, right?
Uh-huh.
And you can also take a punch, but you can't take a sword. You don't want to take any sword cut at all. So there's a lot of fundamental difference with the art.
Okay. And then, so do you still practice Muay Thai or?
Yes, I practice like 1 or 2 days weekly because it helps with the basic stand breathing and like stretching and everything.
Okay. And then, so I mentioned, I mentioned to you before that my brother has a mixed martial arts YouTube channel. And my little brother always talks about Muay Thai, and how I think his background is mostly in Brazilian jiu-jitsu, but he also knows a lot of different methods. So one of the things that he mentioned is that a lot of his subscribers are HEMA people. And so one of my questions was what's the correlation between mixed martial arts and HEMA?
So let's see, in HEMA, there's people we try to make it as accurate as possible.
Uh-huh.
So I don't know about other art, but HEMA, there's gonna be like a lot of different fighting range.
Mm-hmm.
So you can fight with a sword, but if you are getting close with you here, now uh-huh. we're gonna start grappling, maybe I punch you, maybe
okay.
I take down, I do a takedown, anything, so now, there's a lot of mixed variety to it. So if you do only sword, you can cut with sword, but you don't know how to grapple. That's bad, right? So that's why if you do HEMA, then you should learn some basic empty hand,
uh-huh.
some takedown, jiu-jitsu, wrestling, whatever. It's gonna make you dress it like a better overall, better performer. I think that's a side of it. And some other side is that if you train with anything, at all in martial art, there's always some concept in that art that can translate to the other art because like Muay Thai, they're focusing a lot of hard power, like punch, kick, like full contact stuff, right?
Mm-hmm.
But on the small side, there's grapple is like a soft power, and there's a soft energy and how to like read the energy and take down someone else. But in Muay Thai, they don't focus much on that. But on the other side, like Brazilian jiu-jitsu, like wrestling,
uh-huh.
they focus on a lot of soft power, but they still use strength to do soft power. People need like some sort of strength to do any physical stuff, right? But the way I talk about soft, it means like they have to actually read people, how they like, they're gonna grapple you, they're gonna come into your back. When the way they roll around, they have to be able to read the energy, so that's the soft side of like the martial art thing. You should learn more to be like a better person.
Okay, and that's really interesting because I hadn't thought about that because I haven't seen like a whole like scenario played out, and so that makes a lot of sense that you need to know sword fighting, but then when you get close and like if you drop
it's like eating food though.
Yeah,
if you eat only like spicy food and then you have water, now you're gonna still feel spicy, right?
Uh-huh.
But if you have spicy food, then you follow it up with some sweet or like a meal. Now then your overall meal is gonna be feel like full, but still feel good, right? You're not feeling like spicy. So
uh-huh.
Maybe that's not a good metaphor. Maybe like a good meal, then a beer. So now that's like a whole meal for you.
Okay. Oh, and so could you talk about here today because your group did an exhibition, right, for a couple hours?
Today here there's a board game expo behind us. So we here at KX Knowledge Center. I don't know the area here, but we do like a demo for the exhibition. We do like a sword fighting, and then we have SCA doing like a full gear sparring for them.
And then what's SCA?
Society of Anachronism something. I don't.
Oh,
really
Society of something something. Okay.
Creative Anachronism, which is like a really hard name to spell.
Oh,
for me.
Creative Anachronism.
Yeah, I think it has a word.
Okay, I think
it's a tricky word for me to pronounce. So.
Yeah, let me look that up. Is SCA. Yeah, Society for Creative Anachronism.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
A hard word for us.
Oh yeah, that's anachronism is actually one of my favorite words because it means like something out of place in time. So it's a really cool word. Mm. And so you were telling me that Nakhon is Nakhon the guy in charge of the SCA?
Yes, he's like a spokesperson for them.
Okay. So he's the spokesperson, and they're making a like 120 acre
area at Legendary Wagon. So we SCA, HEMA, and Legendary Wagon. This like pretty much our sponsor.
Okay.
So Legendary Game is a Warhammer board game and a shop located in Nonthaburi. You can add a link and I send you.
Oh, yeah.
So they have like a space area, like 100 acre or something. I don't actually know the whole place, but it's huge. And he owned the whole area, and the guys want to promote like medieval stuff. So we kind of like team up with SCA and the shop and us, HEMA, Bangkok Historical Fencing. And we do like a training every week. Every Saturday we have training from like in the morning, 9 a.m. There's gonna be SCA people doing training in the morning. And then we have HEMA training from like 12 p.m. to like 6 p.m. in the afternoon, so 12 to 6. And during the day we do like longsword, saber, and then we have like an archery training, an area that you can do like an archery and stuff, shooting arrows, whatever.
So are you, are you better at archery or swords?
I think it's about the same level now. Because I do a lot of training.
Oh wow! So you're pretty much good at everything.
So I'm gonna quote a name that's gonna revoke a few concerns. So you know Lars Anderson. He's a guy that's like big on YouTube for like a few years that shoot an arrow.
Oh okay.
And that's like it's like a historical Europe. Eastern side of shooting, they do like a thumb ring and stuff, and those like give you like a better speed than normally we see in like an Olympic style shooting. So I do that style of shooting, so that gives us like a fast advantage in shooting, and I can do like a jumping, moving backward, running, and do like a multiple target shooting and speed shooting. But I still don't know. I still haven't tried mounted archery because I failed miserably on that.
Cool. So, how many HEMA
group?
How many people is part of the Bangkok historical fencing?
So we have like an active member that's coming for practice like every week, about 7 or 10 people.
Okay.
And plus the SCA people, that's gonna be like 20 every week.
Okay.
And in the group we have like 100 or 200 people, but in like an active event maybe the max is about 40 people overall. But most of the members, we try to like get the member that actually training, so most of the active member, they know about all the basic stuff and can teach all the new members every time, every day.
Cool. So you mentioned that you don't promote very much, but
because it's like a very niche market here, and people here, they have a tendency to like be afraid of kind of like this stuff. And it's not bad to promote, but it's like worth quite less to promote. We try to get like people that actually interested and come toward us, and then we approach it afterwards.
And so how do people usually find out about you?
So if you search like if you interested in longsword or something, you can search longsword, and then you search like Thailand in Google, it's gonna come up like almost the first one. Always like HEMA Thailand is gonna come up, like Bangkok Historical Fencing or SCA, and there's gonna be like a Facebook page and YouTube channel, and there's a Facebook group. They just message to us and we answer right away, like 30 minutes we already get that answer.
Cool. So what would you say, like, if someone's watching this that is kind of interested, what would you say to somebody that's kind of interested but never did this before?
So I think anything about life, life is short, right? If you have the time to do it, just go ahead and do it. If you want to like practice sword or go running or go do whatever, go eat something. Just if you think about it and you can do it, just go grab something like a steak, a bloom, and go training. And you can pretty much find everything online now. Just like if you want to learn saber, just type saber on YouTube, you're gonna get something. There's a lot of basic video on YouTube, right? Tutorial, classes, you can find that online now. I think everyone can give it a try if they just like take a bit of time to try it. Anything not about sword is anything in life.
Cool. And then what's your favorite sword?
That's a hard question. I think like Thai sword the best. It's probably because I train that a lot. But for like an accessory thing and the thing I buy a lot, that's for like in my collection I have a lot of Thai sword, like 30 or 40 of Thai sword for like.
Oh wow.
And I have like from like low grade to like a high grade. The other thing probably like katana and long sword. But I try to approach this thing like a practical view because each stuff they have their own use in certain situations. Long sword is good for like a brawl or like a duel because it have longer reach and stuff. Katana is more better for like a close quarter fighting because it's shorter but it's more nimble and it's easier to use. But Thai sword is hard, probably the hardest thing to learn. I don't recommend people to try it at first because it's super hard because you have to do two stuff with two hands. It's really confusing and take a lot of time. It's just easier to pick up like katana or long sword and study with it.
So how many swords total do you have?
About 50.
About 50?
50, yes.
Okay. And then I don't know too much about fencing, but fencing's the bendy sword, right?
Yes, like an Olympic fencing. That is evolved from like a rapier.
Okay.
Have you watched like a movie like The Duelist, like an old movie? Like a long sword that's pointy, that's called rapier.
Okay.
That's what the Olympic fencing evolved from. It's evolved from the rapier and the saber.
Okay.
But in Olympic fencing, you just touch the person or like hit with a small light hit, and it's gonna register as a point.
Okay.
And so now they lack the urgency of like self-defense and like a double. So if you actually hit someone and they hit you back at the same time, in sport fencing, if you hit first, you already got the point. You don't have to worry about getting hit. But in real fighting, you don't want to get hit at all. So that's our number one concern in fighting. So we try to teach that to people that you want to fight and actually don't getting hit, but why when you hit that person. So hit the other person, but don't get hit.
And that's actually one of my big questions is about because you mentioned accuracy that you you try to make all the battles very accurate. And my little brother on his YouTube channel, he always talks about how most fights aren't actually accurate. And on one of his recent videos, he said that only the only people that actually make accurate fights are HEMA people, most fights aren't actually like real fights. Most fights are either exhibition fights or like people like it's really hard to see like a real fight. And so that's a question I have is about accuracy and how do you get things to be really accurate.
So I think it's about the way you approach it as when you come to practice. It depends on who the group you are starting with, how they teach the person. So if you go to like Olympic fencing, they can teach you to be fast and beat the other person and not actually care about blocking. But you still have to block some time because you don't want to get hit first and then you score the point, right? But in HEMA, it's based on like an actual manual, an old manual that teach about sword fighting in real life. When people reconstruct that thing and try it, the main goal is they try to promote like a historical accuracy. So now they have to train it so that it promotes that you kill the person and don't get hit.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so a lot of rule books or like a lot of tournaments, they have like a call like a double rule or like a maybe point deduction if you get hit while you, the other person is hitting. So if I hit you and you hit me back in like a second later, so that's gonna call it like an after blow. Because you, I hit you, but you hit me and I don't block it. Maybe sometimes in a real fight, right? I actually cut someone's arm, like I cut your left arm, but the right arm is still holding a sword and you hit me back. In a sport fencing, they doesn't count that into like a consideration.
Okay.
But in HEMA, we count that, so we give like something like an after blow. You have to consider that as they're gonna have some energy left to fight you back.
Uh-huh.
Or there's something like a double that I mentioned before. Double is like I hit you and you hit me at the same time. It's like bam, we both hit each other. So that we count as no point, or maybe if they do that a lot of time without consideration for each other's safety. So it's just gonna keep hitting you and you keep hitting me back at the same time. It's just gonna be disqualify the person out of the tournament. So now that's give a lot more people to concern about actually hitting and not getting hit. But it's not going to be accurate because we train with like blunt sword or like a specialized sword for training and fighting. So people are not actually afraid of the sword, but they're afraid of the rule and stuff. Because in a real fight and stuff, you see the other guys coming at you with a sharp sword that like 40 inches long. It's going to be fucking scary. And it's from my personal experience, I've been like a robbery and stuff, and I have to take my gun and point at the other person. A lot of people is not gonna prepare to do that for things, because you have to like, when you're in a real fight, you have to really like prepare mentally, not just physically, to like take the other person's life, or the other guy will just jump you and kill you. So that's why not a lot of people think about it mentally, but they think just about the rule and physical stuff, but the mental stuff people just forget about it.
Okay. And then, do you ever train with sticks?
Yes, I think every school, in every style of martial art, in every country, they start with sticks.
So they start with sticks?
Maybe stick, like, or maybe wooden sword, I do start with sticks.
Okay. So whenever you start, you always start with a stick before you give someone a sword?
For us now, for me, I try to start people with like a blunt sword.
Oh, okay.
Because not a lot of people mention this, but it's actually true. If you train with stick and then you move to like a blunt sword and then you move to like a sharp sword, that's gonna be a transition period from stick to blunt and then to sharp. Because some technique that you do with stick don't translate to like a blunt sword. Blunt sword don't translate to like a sharp sword. Something you can do here, can do it here, and can do it here. So it's better to like, if you can skip the stick and do like a blunt sword, it's better so you don't have to waste the time here.
So that's why you start people training on the blunt sword.
Yes. So they don't have to waste time transitioning the skill back and forth.
Okay. Can you tell me more about the 120 acres that Macron is making? And is it finished or still in progress?
It's still like a work in progress, but you can always visit it every Saturday in Montgomery.
Okay.
And I hope you're gonna keep on like the location and stuff.
Oh yeah.
Just search the shop name, the Legendary War Game. The space is like a whole space, co-working space. So if you come in every Saturday, it's gonna be training. You can try it, or you can ask about the person in the shop, and they're gonna read the leg to us.
Okay. So is it Legendary War Games is here, and then the 120
yes, so
acres is in the back.
Legendary War Game is here. The archery range is here. The training room is here, and then you can do all around.
Okay. And then Nakon was saying that there's a big place for with air conditioning.
Yes. We have like a small training room with air conditioning, so now we can do like sparring in the mid of summer here, which is like 45 degrees something.
Uh-huh.
And if we do it outside, it's gonna kill us.
Yeah, and that was actually one of my big questions, because whenever I've seen people practicing with swords, it's always been outside. And I know that most Thai people don't like to be outside in the heat, And so, so that was my question. So how big is the inside part?
The training room.
Yeah, with air conditioning.
6 by 5 meter.
Okay.
So that's pretty big for like a training room. Or...
Oh, that's cool. So it's a pretty nice space. And then. Do you guys, when it's raining, do you?
Train inside, definitely. Yes.
Okay.
But sometimes I just take people and train outside. Uh-huh. It's just gonna get wet, and the salt's gonna rust.
Oh yeah. I didn't think about that.
We hate maintaining our salt because everything is steel, right?
Uh-huh.
After training, and with Thailand humidity and stuff and sweat and everything is gonna rust the next day.
Wow. So that's something I didn't think about. So could you tell me about how with a steel sword, what you have to do to make sure it doesn't rust?
It's easy. You train with it. You finish the session. Finish it there. Wipe it with cloth, and then wipe it with cloth and oil, and then you're done.
Okay.
Don't forget to oil your sword, because if I train Saturday and I'm so tired, I live in the car. I wake up in the next morning and like, it's gonna rust, and now I have to do like a 30 minute work of sanding. It's like horrible.
Wow, so it'll rust in just 2 days?
It will rust overnight.
Wow.
Because your hand is sweaty and you touch the sword, there's gonna be like an oil on the body.
Uh-huh.
You're gonna catch on, and with Thailand heat and humidity.
Wow, and so why does oil stop it from rusting?
So it's like a science thing. So when you steel, there's steel and there's no like a surface cover,
okay.
The steel gonna oxidize with the oxygen,
uh-huh.
And the oxidization process gonna create like a rust. So if you oil it, the oil is gonna like make a protective film on it. So now there's no like a process of oxidization, so that there's no rust.
Okay. That's interesting. So are there other like what else do you have to like maintain?
Oil your sword, clean your cloth, wash your helmet, and oil your armor, and check your sparring gear as well.
Okay, and it seems like some of that stuff, like even in air conditioning, would get very 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 hot. Is that?
Yes, so when you're in sparring gear, you have like a jacket, a helmet, maybe like a plastic armor.
Uh-huh.
And then there's a shoulder, there's a kneecap and stuff. So that's pretty much, think of it like a police riot gear. You're in that gear, and then
uh-huh.
You fight with each other with a sword.
And so do people smell really bad?
Oh yeah, we have like one member, I'm not gonna mention the name. He have like an old jacket, I think it's about 5 years old, and he's rarely wash it, and if you walk right to him, you're gonna smell the whole thing.
Oh shit, jacket, it's a jacket.
Yeah, I had an old roommate in college, and he would always go biking, like 200 kilometer bicycling.
He's gonna smell.
Oh yeah, and so after his 200, because I think it took him about like eight or 10 hours to bike, so he, his stuff just smelled really bad.
Have you tried
really
bad. Talking about like smell and stuff? Have you tried like a Muay Thai gym, like a big Muay Thai gym that's gonna have like a glove,
uh-huh.
For like a loaner glove and stuff that have been used like for like 100 person and 100 obsession.
Uh-huh.
You stick your hand in that glove. And you take it out, it's gonna smell the whole day. It's that bad.
Wow. So when you're recreating, then do you focus a lot on the fighting, but you also dress up in gear too, right?
So the goal HEMA. So the concept is we try to fight with non-armor opponent. So we train to simulate like a non-armor fight. So you actually get
Okay, and we're back because my my camera cuts out after 30 minutes. So so I think we were talking about so you you prepare with sword fighting, but then what other things do you prepare? Like do you prepare clothing or other things?
So if you're just like a new person that's coming in to try class or trying the sword and stuff, just like get dressed in like a sportwear or whatever, something that's stretch, because you're probably gonna rip your pants a lot. Training, I do that myself sometimes. So just come in with like a fresh mindset for learning,
okay.
And pretty much just get. If you have a sword, you can start training, because most stuff you want to do as a basic, you don't have to actually hit a person or getting hit. You just want to go with like a movement, a basic drill like cut left, cut right, block left, block right, maybe overhead block, and then you hit back or something.
Uh-huh.
And we try to go slow. Because people that actually just haven't learned stuff or like haven't do physical stuff like this, they tend to be like try to go fast, and it's gonna actually hurt the other person and the training partner, or maybe you actually like hurt yourself as well because you're going fast with the sword and stuff. So basically just come up anywhere, any club you find in the world, mm-hmm. just approach them, go with the right mindset and just ask for a class or whatever. Most clubs, they're going to have like a beginner stuff for you and stuff for you to learn and try. You just come in and you can try. And then if you go, like you like it, you want to try more, you want to like actually try this stuff, maybe you first get a sword and then maybe a glove and a helmet, because that's like a basic stuff for you. And if you like actually like to sparring, then you get like a jacket and like other protective equipment.
Cool. So can you, can you tell me like about it? Cause I know that's a sword, but I don't know.
So this one is a long sword.
Okay.
So long sword is basically translated like long sword, uh-huh. like in English. So, there's a difference from like, other sword you see in the movie. So long sword have like a long blade. So that's basically the name. And the thing that distinguishes longsword from European sword from other style, they have like a big guard here, right? They call uh-huh. it cross guard, or maybe let's just call it cross guard.
Uh-huh.
So the thing is, you look like cross, and this thing actually act as a shield as well, not just for like a hand guard. It's basically you hold it two hand, now you don't have a shield, right?
Mm-hmm.
But this thing acts as your shield, because if someone hit you, you can use it to block or
okay.
redirect and stuff. And you can actually hit someone and use this one to block the hit as well. So that's like a distinctive thing about longsword. And then it's like gonna be a big handle, long handle, and then it's gonna be a big wild pommel. So this is like a counterweight. So this is like a.
Oh, okay. So this is a pretty heavy weight.
Yes.
So
this thing is for like balancing, because there's a long blade. We want to something that's heavy in the end. So now it's make it nimble, really fast to use.
Oh, cool. And
so what should we talk about? Maybe we can try like GitHub and show you a few moves or whatever.
Oh yeah, that would be great if you could. I don't know if you can capture it on the camera, but. But that's a pretty cool demo.
If you come early, you're gonna see the whole thing. But yeah, never mind.
Oh yeah. So today, can you describe like the whole? Because you did a demo for about 2 hours, right?
Yeah, so about an hour and 2 hours. So it went pretty good, but I think a lot of our people here, they do a lot of board games, and people that do board games, there's like a huge nerd.
Uh-huh.
Things and sword people is also a huge nerd, but we kind of like a different nerd kind of thing. So I think we're not gonna get a lot of publicity, but the event went well and a lot of people is interested. There's still people now asking about stuff with our sword here.
Cool.
So that's pretty good for us.
That's awesome. So do you play board games?
I try it. It's very addictive. So I try not to do it a lot because I want to take my time with sword.
And so what's your favorite board game?
There's like an old school game that's in Thailand. It's like summoner card thing. I do that for quite a few years when I was in high school. And now I actually like playing like a risk card game, the one that you control territory. Okay. And then you try to gain the whole world or something. That I like that type of game, not like an actual like RPG itself. But there's a lot of board game type that I have learned.
And then with the HEMA and SEA people,
yes.
Do most of them play board games and do HEMA SEA?
We kind of like everyone do it at some point because we read the legendary games they do Warhammer stuff, like an official Warhammer in Thailand. So if you walk in the shop, there's going to be a whole set of Warhammer, and there's a painting shop, there's an area where you can take a thing and do the modeling and stuff. So I have like a set, but I tried for like a few months and it's not my thing. But yeah, the shop have board game and they have Warhammer painting and everything. And I remember like after training, then they start playing board game to like meet guys.
Cool. So, how many of your members are Thai people and how many of your members are foreigners?
For now it's about 90% Thai people. The foreigner here is they mostly got like a different time schedule, so we don't meet them a lot of them. The one that came up gonna be like instructor or like a traveling instructor that come in like once a month or something. But the other like foreigner member, they have like a lot of weird schedule because a lot of foreigners usually work like Saturday and Sunday, but most Thai people they work like a work day. So there's like a conflict of schedule, so sometimes we get foreigner people coming.
Okay, and you mentioned that you mentioned about like people traveling and people coming to Bangkok and doing training with your group. Can you talk more about that and like some of the people that have come to do training?
So we last 2 years we have a big competitive fencer. I don't remember the name anymore. But there's the other guy that came in at the same time. He teaches like a big Polish saber teacher in Poland or something. His name is Jersey. He teaches us the whole class on basic Polish saber. And that's like a hard class. So we do like 4 or 5 hours for 3 days. And at the end of the session, the 3 day session, some of our members just get sick because of the intensity of training. And about the training, people coming in, even next week we have people from the US, it's from like a big HEMA people. I think his name is John Phoenix. He's like a lead instructor with Richard Martin, who is also like a big HEMA name. Maybe he's like a HEMA head group or something or somewhere, I don't remember the names. And he's gonna come and teach us next week also on Sunday at Sword Lumpini.
Oh wow!
So that's good because we have people coming in all the time.
Cool. Who else has come to do training?
Oh, so Jersey, Johnson is gonna come. The guy I don't remember the name. I just came up on my TS school. He's like a world champion or some like big competitors. And we have Pontus Weicker, he's like our founder member and our first instructor. And there's a few people that I don't remember the names, that's bad for me, but we appreciate that teaching and other stuff, but I don't remember the name, so that's on me.
So European, with the European influence, there's like France and Italy and England. Where most of your which country do most of the
stuff to do.
Yeah.
So in sort European martial art.
Yeah.
So that with long sword, there's two main style that people is doing. So there's a German style and there's an Italian style.
Okay.
So we do kind of like a mix of both because we actually don't have like a legit instructor here. So we try to like grab a text from German and then we try it. And then in some other area that the German doesn't focus on, and then we look for like an Italian stuff. So Italian is like a more grappling style, while like a German is more like a movement of blade and stuff. So we try to combine that. So we don't actually like focus just one of them. We try it all, and what works for us, we keep it. And that's what we try to do.
Okay. Cool. And I've seen a few YouTubers that have really interesting channels about swords. And so one of my questions is which YouTube channels do you watch?
Matt Eason, number one, School of Gladiators, based in UK. He's like a big HEMA teacher and instructor in UK. He teaches longsword and saber, but I think he's focused on saber now. That's number one for me. The second guy is his Academy of Historical Fencing. I think his name is Nick something. Mm-hmm. And he's a big HEMA instructor and YouTube guy on YouTube as well. And other person maybe like Chat Diversity, Metatron, or maybe Scalakim. But those three guys, they're not like a HEMA instructor, but they're more like a YouTuber that focus on HEMA and stuff.
Okay.
So if you want to try like and get like a from like a good source to try, like Matt Eason is my number one to go to.
Okay. And then so one of the things I was surprised about is that the whole page is in English, right?
Yes.
I've talked to a lot of Thai people, and a lot of Thai people don't have great English. So one of my questions is why is your English so good?
Well, I'm fortunate to have like a good education and stuff. So I started 12 years in like a private school.
Okay.
But that's good for me, and I also take like an exchange program. So I take like a 1 year program to Denver.
Oh, okay.
That's a 1 year experience. And I study in Surau, gone for like a college university. And I study like an English program. So it's international program, so that's another 4 years of English. And a lot of stuff we do, a lot of instruction and a lot of work I do, all English related stuff because I trade like a community, AG community, so like a corn, soybean and stuff, and I talk with like foreigner every day, every night. So that's why I'm very good.
So your regular job is trading?
Yes,
trading commodities?
Yes, trading community to like a factory in Thailand.
Uh-huh.
So I have to speak English with people every day.
So that's interesting.
Even my Thai client, they send me an email in Thai. I just answer in English.
Almost everyone that I've met who in Thailand, like even if they say, oh my, I can't speak English.
People can speak English, but they're afraid to try it. Thai people, they tend to like. Afraid of doing something that they not good at, but in your other person, like foreigner, they don't care, right?
Uh-huh.
You don't care if you're gonna make mistakes, if you can get the message out and you get it. So if I say like something wrong, I don't care. If you get the message or you partially get the message, that's good for me. That's good enough. That's the point of conversation. But most Thai people, they kind of like afraid of that idea about they're gonna make mistake and they're gonna be embarrassed. But that's the thing about communication, right? You just want to talk.
So how did you learn that? Because I meet so many Thai people, and I can tell they want to practice English, but they just get too afraid and they say I can't.
At one point I was like that before I went to exchange program. We think that trying to like be active and talk in front of class and make mistakes bad, right? But if you actually like been with like foreigner, talk a lot with other person from your natural language, they don't actually, nobody cares about yourself at all. Nobody cares about everything about yourself, even like the way you talk or the way you do with life. Mm-hmm. So people doesn't bother with you, so why do you have to bother? Just talk with them, you can get the message out, they get it, that's good. And they understand, right? You speak English every day, but we speak Thai, and then we start English. You know already that we're not gonna be good at it. So people doesn't care. We just talk with them. It's gonna be good at some point.
Yeah, and that's something that I think because Thai people always want to be very, very good and to be perfect. And so sometimes I notice that they want to be perfect so much that they that they won't.
Everybody wants to be perfect because if they don't do something bad, right? If I'm bad at English and I don't talk to you, that means I'm perfect, right? Because I haven't made mistake, right? Mm-hmm. But if I talk to you and I make like a mistake, now I'm not perfect. So that's like a bad mindset for stuff because nobody is perfect in this world. You're gonna make some mistake at some point, so just leave it is, because if you think like that, you're gonna have a lot of stress.
Cool. That's a really good philosophy. And that's I'm trying to learn Thai too, and I try to remember that.
Yeah, also. If you speak Thai with me, I don't care what you say. It's gonna be like, you can try that again.
Oh, and so your name, Bright. So how do you spell Bright in English, and how do you spell Bright in Thai? B-R-I...
Bright is bright light.
Like B-R...
B-R-I-G-H, so bright.
Okay.
So in Thai, is, if you spell Thai English, it's gonna be Sala-I, the big I thing. And then it's gonna be Bo-Bai-Mai. รอเรือกะลันบนรอเรือนะแล้วก็ทอทหาร so that's like an the sound of it but there's another Thai name in Sanskrit stuff that's gonna Chittiwood which the meaning is translated to like a bright or brilliant person so there's another Thai name it's like a English then there's a Latin so there's a Thai as a pronunciation that's translated to English and there's a Thai in like a Sanskrit thing that's translated to another meaning. That's a weird stuff.
And then what's that one?
So it's Chittiwood, and it's pretty basically the same meaning.
Oh, okay. Oh, so your regular Thai name also means bright?
Yes, in a sense, yes.
Okay, that's kind of cool, because a lot of times people's regular name isn't really connected to their nickname.
Yeah, but a lot of U.S. name is like biblical name.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Like Joseph.
Yeah, and like Joseph, my name is a biblical name. cool. So anything that we didn't talk about yet?
I think we cover like a lot. We talk like an hour or something.
Yeah.
It's almost an hour.
Yeah, almost an hour.
So I'm just gonna leave a sponsor here. So check us out at Legendary War Game or Bangkok Historical Fencing. Search it on Facebook and you're gonna find us, message us, and we're gonna get back to you.
Okay, and thank you so much. This has been a great interview.
It's a pleasure, no problem.
And I learned a whole bunch about fencing and everything else. So thanks very much.
Yeah, so stick around, we can talk later.
Okay.
Interview is over. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Bye.